Welcome to worship this morning. A special welcome to all those visiting with us. We're happy to have you here. And everyone who's joining us online in worship, welcome. You'll find in the front of your bulletin, we have some announcements, some upcoming events. Today is Penny Sunday, so if you have any change for the kids, if you want to give that to them before the children's message, and then they'll bring that up. And we want to thank you for your generosity. This year we're collecting, our penny donations are going to the fire company across the street. Today in worship, we also have Pastor Linda Johnson Sayankulu. She is the missionary who's been serving in Liberia that we've been supporting. This year, she's retiring after years of service, so we're very excited to have her here. She's going to say something a little bit. She just had to grab something in her car. Today also is the crop walk. The registration begins at 1:30, and the walk begins at 2 at Walker Township. If you have any donations, you want to give those to Chris. The crop walk is an effort to end world hunger, both around the world and also in our local community. So 25% of everything that we raise will actually go to the Juniata County Food Pantry. And then today, this evening, from 5 to 7, we'll have our Community Fall Festival. That's for people of all ages. There'll be food and activities. There'll be a photo booth kind of thing. So we thank Derek and the Faith Formation team for helping lead this event. And it's rain or shine, so whatever the weather is, we'll have it in here or we'll have it at St. Peter's Grove. I think, have we planning St. Peter's Grove? Okay, we're planning for outside. Awesome. Great. Next Sunday, October 20th, Dr. Carla Bombach will be leading worship while I'm on vacation. If there are any pastoral emergencies, if you need emergency pastoral care, you can call the office, and Pastor Jim has graciously agreed to serve as our on-call pastor for that time.
Stay well.
Stay well. That Sunday, October 20th, is also when we'll have mums and pumpkins available, and those are to take to members in the community who, you know, just want to let them know that we're thinking about them, praying for them. So those will be available after worship. And then coming up at the last Sunday of October, the 27th, is already Reformation Sunday. So everyone's invited to wear red that day, and we'll also be giving out some Bibles to some of our older children who are able to have the text Bibles now, so we'll be blessing them as well. And then coming up, the first Sunday of November is All Saints Sunday, and so we'll be remembering those who have died in this past year and also all of our loved ones, and so you're invited to bring in pictures of your loved ones, and we'll have a little table up here that we can display them. Are there other announcements?
Yes, we had a meeting at for Faith Formation, and we are definitely going to go see Christmas Wonderland at the Christian Life Assembly Church on December 8th, I think it is. So now we have a new sign up back there. So if you want tickets, this is actually for ordering the tickets. Please sign your name, sign how many you want. There is, we just found out the other night when we had our meeting, there's an adult price and a children's price. So children 5 to 18 is only $10 a ticket, 18 and older is 15, and 4 and under are not permitted to go. We are not going to take a bus, however, we do have a van accessible and or we can carpool, so if you're in need of a ride, we will get you there. So don't let that deter you from signing up. And we need your payment with the ticket because we're going to order the tickets October 21st. If you order 20 or more tickets, you can order early so that we can all be in the same section. And we have 42 sign up from the last prior list of people interested. So we're going to definitely take advantage of that. So if you have any questions, see somebody at Faith Formation. But when you do, just pay somebody from Faith Formation with your name on an envelope and we'll mark you off as paid.
Great. Thank you, Chris. So we are definitely going to have a church trip to Christmas Wonderland play that's going to go on in Camp Hill December 8th,
yeah,
right? Sunday, December 8th. It's a Sunday afternoon. So even if you did sign up last time, that was just to get an idea of the interest. So now you're signing up for the tickets. So we'll need your sign up and paying for your ticket by next Sunday, because we want to order them early because the tickets go fast. This is a very popular show. So, but we do have the ability to carpool or a van available if you would need a ride. So thank you. Other announcements? Yes, Gary.
After the service, I'll be sitting at this white table back here in the Northex. I have information about Camp Mount Luther. If you were at camp last week and you decided on an amount that you want to contribute, I'll take that paper. If you weren't there, you could take a commitment paper, take a brochure about camp, think about, take it home, think about it, bring it back next week, the week after. So just stop by the table if you have questions about or are interested in contributing to Camp Mount Luther.
Thank you, Gary. Yeah, so there's a table in the back about the Camp Mount Luther campaign. So if you're interested in making a pledge or just have any questions for Gary, you can find more information back there. Thank you. Any others?
Yes.
Ooh.
So I want to thank everybody for their prayers. My hip surgery went excellent. I'm up and moving again. So thank you so much for that. And also, we will have a willing worker meeting this Tuesday at 2:00 in the afternoon back in the library. So if you're around, please stop in.
So a willing workers meeting.
We need to get started on our bazaar thing.
Mm-hmm. The bazaar is coming up.
Yes.
So the Willing Workers will meet on Tuesday at 2 p.m. at the library here. Yes. And we're excited, Judy, that your surgery went so well and you're moving around. That's great. Yeah. Awesome. Trudy.
This afternoon at Greenwood High School, the Greenwood Community Band will perform their annual concert. It's at 3:00. Excuse me. And all are welcome.
Right.
And
the
it's
Greenwood.
It's always good.
It's always good. There you go. Endorsement. Yeah. So the Greenwood Community Band at 3:00 at Greenwood?
At Greenwood High School.
At Greenwood High School. Great. Wonderful. Any other joys or concerns to share? All right. I want to invite Linda, Pastor Linda, up. She wanted to share a few words before we get started with worship. And as I mentioned, she's the missionary that we've been supporting from Liberia, and this year she will be retiring after many years of service.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Sorry to walk in late. I forgot something in the car. So it's good to be with you again. I haven't been with you on a Sunday morning for a very long time, so it's good. I've been at Vacation Bible School and I think Women's Bible Study or something, but it's good to be with everybody this morning. Thank you for sponsoring my work in Liberia, West Africa. My work there has been to teach lay leaders and ministers about theology. Specifically, I was teaching New Testament, church history, preaching, pastoral care, sort of a wide variety of things. But as I am retiring January 1st, and so I came to say thank you and goodbye and to encourage you to continue to support mission in Liberia, West Africa. Good to be with you.
Please rise as you're able. Prepare our hearts and minds for worship with our confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin and come to God for healing. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have honored you with our lips, but have harmed our neighbors with our tongues. The cravings at war within us cause conflicts and disputes. In our desire to be first, we make distinctions among ourselves. We place the needs of the poor and the suffering last. In your great mercy, forgive us our sins. Draw near to us with grace in time of need, and turn us to follow in the way of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
God promises to forgive our iniquity and to remember our sin no more. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, the source of eternal healing, your sins are forgiven.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, increase in us your gift of faith, that forsaking what lies behind and reaching out to what lies ahead, we may follow the way of your commandments and receive the crown of everlasting joy. through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Amen. Please be seated.
The first lesson is taken from the fifth chapter of Amos. Seek the Lord and live, or he will break out against the house of Joseph like fire, and it will devour Bethel, with no one to quench it. All you that turn justice to wormwood and bring righteousness to the ground. They hate the one who reproves in the gate, and they harbor the one who speaks the truth. Therefore, because you trample on the poor and take from them levies of grain, you have built houses of hewn stone, but you shall not live in them. You have planted pleasant vineyards, but you shall not drink their wine. For I know how many are your transgressions and how great are your sins. You who afflict the righteous, who take a bribe and push aside the needy in the gate. Therefore, the prudent will keep silent in such a time, for it is an evil time. Seek good and not evil, that you may live, so that the Lord, the God of hosts, will be with you. Just as you have said, hate evil and love good, and establish justice in the gate. It may be the Lord, the God of hosts, will be gracious to the remnant of Joseph. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We will read the psalm responsively. So teach us to number our days, that we may apply our hearts to wisdom.
Return, O Lord, how long will you tarry? Be gracious to your servants.
Satisfy us by your steadfast love in the morning, so shall we rejoice and be glad all our days.
Make us glad as many days as you afflicted us, and as many years as we suffered adversity.
Show your servants your works and your splendor to their children.
Rain down.
The second lesson is from the fourth chapter of Hebrews. Indeed, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of our heart. And before him, no creature is hidden, but all are naked and laid bare to the eyes of the one to whom we must render an account. Since then, we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God. Let us hold fast to our confession, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weakness, but we have one who in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need. The word of the Lord.
Yeah, and you know, I'm going to stand up because I hurt my leg, and if I sit down, you all are going to have to help me up. It would not be fun. So, okay? So, hello, I'm Pastor Linda, and I live in Liberia. Do you know where Liberia is? It's in Africa. So, let me show. Africa goes like this, right? So, if you're going like this, Liberia is right in that. The bottom part of the rounded part. So we have some people from this church that have been to Liberia. Did you know that? No? Raise your hand if you've been to Liberia. Pastor? Sharon in the back? And there have been a few other people, but they're not here today, I don't think. So Liberia is a long ways away. My children live in the United States. They're old. You wouldn't think they were children anymore. But what I hadn't figured out was when we moved to Liberia, they said, you know, you went 5,000 miles away from us. 5,000 miles is a really long ways, huh? I drove 36 miles to get here today, and that seemed like a long time, but 5,000 miles is really long. Anyway, there are children like you in Liberia, and I want to introduce you to them, to three of them. Do they look like they're kind of fun? Okay, so this is Bishop. This is Koto. And this is Mavaya. Bishop has a twin sister named Linda. She's named after me. He's named after my husband. Koto is the second child of five children in her family. And Mavaya is the only girl in her family. So she's really kind of tough. She knows how to get along with things. But they all go to a Lutheran church in Liberia. Little bit different than this church, but still a Lutheran church with some of the same things that we do here. But they speak a different language. They speak English, like you do, but they also speak Bella. And so when they are praying and saying thank you to God, instead of saying, thank you, God, you say that in your prayers, right? Do you? Thank you, God. They say, Gala Mama. Can you say that? Let me say it. Oh, it's four syllables. You can say it. Gala. Say it after me. Gala Mama. You can all help me. Gala Mama means thank you, God. Gala is God. Mama is thank you. So if Pastor Karen does something nice for you, you could just say, instead of saying thank you, you could say Mama. She might think you were calling her Mama, but you're saying Mama. It's just different in how you pronounce it. So what we're going to do today is to pray the way Bishop Koto and Mavaya would pray. So they would pray for the same things. So I will say a prayer, and then you will say with me and with the whole congregation, Gala Mama. All right? Okay. You ready? Is everybody ready? No? Do we need to say it again? Gala. Gala. Mama. Okay. So let's fold our hands and pray. God, we thank you for this day and for the beautiful fall colors. Gala Mama. Everybody, Gala Mama. We thank you for the people who take care of us, who feed us, who get us ready for church and send us to school. Gala Mama. We thank you today for this place, for worshiping here. We thank you, God, that you are with us. And we say Gala Mama. Everybody, Gala Mama. We thank you for time to sing songs and to pray. Gala Mama. And God, today we thank you for Bishop, for Koto, and for Mavaya. We ask that you bless them, that you keep them in your care, and we say thank you for them. We say Gala Mama. And now, God, as we go back to our seats, we ask that you help us to live our lives saying each and every day, Gala Mama. Amen. Thanks for coming up.
Holy Gospel according to St. Mark in the 10th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he had heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. "For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise
to you, O Christ. Please be seated.
God's grace, mercy, and peace to you on this day. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, in a world that can be confusing, where people have many differences, we know that you are one God and that your Spirit and you live inside us. We pray today that we will follow your Spirit, that we will follow your ways. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, good morning, people of Trinity. Good to be with you today in the house of the Lord. Good to be here. I bring you greetings today from the Bishop of the Lutheran Church in Liberia, Bishop G. Victor Padmore. He and my colleagues and friends, the pastors and deacons and evangelists and people of the Lutheran Church in Liberia said to say hi. They are filled with God's Spirit in their worship, and they said to thank you for your support of my ministry in Liberia. It's great to be back here in the Upper Susquehanna Synod, and I have to say, so exciting to be here in the fall. I've not been in the United States in the fall for over 10 years, and I grew up in northern Minnesota, so, you know, fall is a big time for us there with the colors of the trees and stuff, so it's really good to be here. My home now is in Liberia, West Africa, with my husband, who is the Bishop Emeritus of the Lutheran Church in Liberia, Jensen Sayankulo. We live in Monrovia, the capital city of Liberia, and we also live part-time on our farm, which is near where I was teaching in Totota, Liberia. On that farm, we grow rice, fish, palms, and cocoa. And I'll be around in fellowship hour if you have questions about life and ministry and things like that in Liberia. So I look forward to being able to talk with you about that. I am going to preach today on a text from Amos, not the one that we heard this morning, although I am going to say just a few words about that, but specifically chapter 7, verses 7 and 8. The prophet Amos was a farmer, a working man. He was not a professional prophet till God called him to be a prophet. I'm not sure he was too anxious to leave his farm and his work, but he did go to be a prophet to speak God's word and witness to God's presence to the people of God. Amos comes to the people of Israel who are confused about what's important. You heard when Sharon read this morning that Amos was saying that you're telling the people, you're doing all these bad things. Did you hear that when she was reading that? So God was not happy with the people of Israel because they are not living the way that God wants them to live. So Amos brings this message from God to the people of Israel, and it is this is what he says. This is what he showed me, Amos says. The Lord was standing by a wall built with a plumb line in his hand. Raise your hand if you know what a plumb line is. Raise your hand if you don't know what a plumb line is. Yeah, okay, thank you. I think there are other people who don't know what a plumb line is. A plumb line is a heavy weight, and it has a string tied to it. And if you hold it up next to, like if I held it up next to this, it would show us, because the plumb line goes exactly straight, it would show us if this is straight. This looks pretty straight to me. So my guess is if we held this up, it would look straight. But people use that for when they're constructing things. When I construct things, they often end up looking like this. That's not how it's supposed to be. If you build a house and it looks like this, you have a problem. So the plumb line is a very simple thing that helps you to know when you are doing the straight thing. So this is what God showed to Amos. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand, and the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I, Amos, said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, and this is the important part, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. God sends Amos to the people of Israel because they seem to have lost their way. They weren't taking care of the poor. They weren't doing righteous living. They weren't seeking justice. Maybe it seems that they had lost their understanding and how to follow God's way for them. God sends Amos to challenge the people of God about living the way God wants them to live. It was confusing to them. They were living among people who thought differently than they did, who had some different habits and different customs, and it was confusing to them. You know, it can be confusing when that's the case, can't it? So it was confusing to the people of God in Amos' time, and God sends Amos to make it clear. And Amos shares God's message with the people. God is setting a plumb line in the midst of the people of Israel. Now that would have been a clear message, something people would understand. Some of us maybe didn't understand exactly what that meant, but you can see that holding something that has a heavy weight at the end makes a straight line that can help you to make something straight. It's important to have something that keeps you straight. So God tells the people that God has set a plumb line in the midst of the people so the people will be able to stand firm in the ways of God, stand firm in what is important for God's creation and community. So, you know, I live in Liberia. Living there has challenged me to think and understand what are God's ways. I say that because everything there, well, not everything, but many things there are different from what I was taught were important to God. In worship, I was taught to sit still. Is that? Sit still. I love to dance. So when I was a kid and they'd start playing really good music, I'd start moving with the music and my mother would say, sit still, Linda. I was taught not to clap during singing. In fact, my mother, who died a couple years ago, was still upset when people would clap after the choir sang, because you just didn't do clapping in worship. I was taught to pray a certain way, to sing certain songs. That was my worship experience. In Liberia, we move and dance, right? Karen? Sharon? Huh? Yeah. Sometimes people will leave their seats from the congregation. You might get up and come up here and start dancing. She's going, oh, no, no. people, sometimes if the sermon is going on and they really are moved by it, somebody will start singing. And if that happened here today, I would just stop and let them sing for a little bit. Sometimes I would have to start talking again so they'd stop singing. But it's just much more free. In Liberia, we clap and drum during singing, and we sing songs from the ELCA books, from Nigerian praise bands, from Pella and Loma dialect choirs. It's just so different. Growing up Lutheran in my Norwegian American household, I was taught that living a certain way was important. And that meant you were following God. And in our house, that was no drinking, no dancing, no card playing. In Liberia, a glass of, or two or three of palm wine is a normal enjoyment in the day by people who I know are committed Christians. And dancing at any time or place, especially during worship, is normal, and if it doesn't happen, people think something's wrong. Growing up in my house, we were taught to hold what we had to ourselves and maybe to be a little suspicious about people who appeared needy. We were taught that guests had a limited time in which they could be hosted in our houses, in our homes. My children, by the time they were 4 and 6, learned from their Liberian family the importance of sharing with those in need. And at a young age, they could tell the difference between mommy's family and daddy's family. My husband is Liberian. I said he was the bishop of the Lutheran Church in Liberia, the bishop emeritus. I didn't say that he's Liberian. And we have Liberian relatives that our children have been with in addition to mine. My 5-year-old once said, with mommy's family, we can go stay 3 to 4 days max. And with daddy's family, we can go and stay forever. Really. I admit at times these differences when I'm in Liberia confuse me. Culture becomes tied up and knotted with faithful living. If they were really Christian, this is what they would do, say, and believe. It gets tied up with how to be in relationship and what it means to be a good, thoughtful person. If I am eating and somebody stops by my house, if I don't say to them, come, let's eat, they think there's something wrong with me. They don't always take the food, because that's the other part. They understand sometimes not to. But sometimes I have wondered how to live as a faithful follower of Jesus Christ when I've been taught to do things a certain way, to be a certain way where I live and work and worship with people who are faithful followers of Jesus Christ but do things differently. They act in different ways. They value some things more than I hold to be important. Some of the women who are my mother's age dance like crazy to celebrate Jesus in their lives while my mother sits and celebrates Jesus in her lives. I share these examples because those differences can put up barriers between the people of God and the community they are a part of. That's what was happening with the people of Israel. What is oh so important to us in the moment may not be the most important thing to God if it is something that breaks up community and relationship. For the people of Israel, fitting into community, getting ahead, worship and sacrifice had become their focus. Worship and sacrifice had become important. Their worship was good. They celebrated God in the midst of their worship, but their practice as a people of God was lacking. They had no concern for the people in the community around them, for the poor, for those in need. What is interesting is that the centerpiece of the book of Amos is in chapter 5, which is right before the plumb line. Sharon read part of that chapter. I'm going to do a little bit more in that chapter. This is where Amos tells the people that God is saying to them, God is telling Amos to tell the people of God that God abhors, God hates your worship. God says that to the people. God says central to life as the people of God is something different than good worship, and it is this. Let justice roll down like water and righteousness come from you like a never, ever flowing stream. Let right living be so much a part of your life that it just flows out of you and people see it. As God instructs through Amos, water and righteousness, God comes through with a plumb line, which God puts in the middle of God's people, which God holds up in the middle of God's people, which God holds up in our presence to help us stay straight, to help us build strong communities where we live, to help us stay straight in our lives as God's people ourselves. Are you hearing me, people of God? God's understanding of justice and right living are only possible for us when we know and understand that God has set a plumb line, God's presence, God's straightening presence in our midst. So I want to share a story. I think stories help make things clear. I had a student, I teach at the Lewis T. Bowers Lay Leaders and Ministers Training Center in Totota, Liberia, and we train evangelists, deacons, and we do continuing education for pastors and lay leaders. But the evangelists come for a two-year program, which the ELCA actually helps to fund. So this is a program that is a part of Trinity, in addition to my ministry there. So the people come for 2 years. For 9 weeks, they study. Then they have some time off. Then they study for another 9 weeks, have some time off. They do 4 sessions. Many of them, when they come, don't know how to read at all. And we work really hard with language arts and using what we're teaching people to keep enforcing, helping them to learn how to read. So mommy came from way in the interior across one of the worst roads I've been on in my life. But I think mommy and her congregation had a clear understanding of what it means to have God's plumb line in the midst of your congregation and in yourself. Mommy came to study with us. When she went back, she was made a deacon, ordained as a deacon to that place, and she was leading the congregation. It was a small village, and there was an elder in the village who was very important. I mean, this guy had so much power that when he got mad at the Lutherans, can you imagine? He just got mad at the Lutherans. And he rerouted the road that went through the center of town, rerouted it so it went around this way so that they did not have to go past the Lutheran church. He told the people in the village, do not speak to the Lutherans, shun the Lutherans. This went on for quite a long time, and then the elder got sick. Well, the Lutherans were pretty upset with him, you can imagine, right? It's a small village. But he got sick, and mommy, holding the plumb line in herself and in front of her congregation, sent her prayer team to go pray with him 2 to 3 times a week. And then she herself, the leader of the Lutheran congregation he was not speaking to, would go and pray with him to help pray that he would get well. Well, what do you think happened? Anybody? He got well, and he gave all praise and thanks to God and the Lutherans. He was so happy. He became a Lutheran. He joined the church. Before you ask, I don't know if he rerouted the road. Someone asked that. I have no idea. But he stopped. The village stopped shunning the Lutherans. He became a Lutheran. Now, I think that's an interesting story. Worldwide, we live in a time where when people see things differently than each other, they just cut each other off, right? I mean, mommy could have done that. Instead, she sent her people and herself to go and pray with this man because that's what God called her to do. She held on to God's presence, that plumb line that keeps us straight and helps us know where to go, and she also showed it to her congregation. Because see, when God comes and puts a plumb line in the midst of the congregation, it doesn't stay here in the building. That's the important thing. God called the people of Israel, and God calls us to take that plumb line inside ourselves, and when we leave here, strengthened by the word and the sacrament, when we leave here carrying that plumb line with us, we go out and we live lives that are about justice and righteousness in the midst of differences with our neighbors, friends, and families, like mommy and the elder. God calls us to be generous in ways that we may find to be uncomfortable. God calls us to live in love with those who think and act and are different from us but are our neighbors. But the thing that's so important is God does not call us to do this alone. It's not like I get up from church and I think, oh, I have to go be righteous. No. I do that knowing that God has called me to do that and that God goes with me. God goes with you. God goes with all of us as we live out what God is calling us to do. God's presence with us helps us to see and know others in ways that go beyond all those things that separate us. Go beyond what we know to be right, like all those things I learned about what it means to be a Christian when I was a kid and how other Christians do it differently. God's presence allows us to be flowing waters of justice and never drying up streams of God-led, healthy, right living. God, through Amos, was calling us to do this. I know the reality of God's plumb line inside myself. God's centering presence has made me to know and to understand how God is so much bigger than what I learned. And so today I come to you, and using the words of Amos, I say to you, God has set a plumb line in the midst of the congregation, and I think in the midst of everyone, inside everyone in the congregation, that will bless them and give them a clear and certain sense that God's plumb line strengthens you, keeps you straight and open. So, God's blessings on you, Trinity. May God's blessings on your waters and streams of justice and righteousness flow throughout your communities, through your relationships, your families, your friends. Amen.
Please join me in the words of our faith through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Challenged by God's word in Christ, let us pray for the church, the world, and the whole creation. Compassionate God, embolden the church to seek all who are lost, clothe those who are naked, and mend that is broken. May we be generous bearers of your eternal love, God of grace. Sustaining God, as we approach harvest time, we pray for farmers, field workers, and those who process crops. Keep us mindful of environmental threats to the nourishing foods that feeds the world. Be with all affected by natural disaster, God of grace. Steadfast God, inspire world leaders to share resources and work collectively to end global poverty, starvation, and preventable diseases. Direct us to seek justice and equity, that all may live in peace. Thank you for the mission and ministry of Pastor Lyndon Johnson. Please bless her and her loved ones, God of grace. Loving God, we pray for those who are afflicted, tormented, grieving, oppressed, and lonely, especially Raymond, Mike, Phyllis, Chris, Barry, Joanne, Gary, Diane, Carl, Kathy, Isabella, Chris, and all others we now name. Deliver the strength of your love and compassion to all who need it today, God of grace. Generous God, we give thanks for the First Nations and tribes who inhabited this land. We lament and harm done by colonization. Call us to deeper appreciation and care for the languages, rituals, and history of all indigenous people, God of grace. Ever-living God, we rejoice to be heirs of eternal life, made real in Jesus' death and resurrection. We give thanks for saints and of all times and places, first and last, who still inspire us to faithful living, God of grace. Into your hands, O God, we commend for whom we pray, trusting in saving grace you freely give, both now and forever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of peace with one another, however you feel comfortable. Blessed are you, O God, source of every gift of your creation. By these gifts and with our lives, help us to serve one another and all in need, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary that we should at all times and in all places offer thanks and praise to you, O Lord, Holy Father, through Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Jesus welcomes you to this table. Come, here is your God. Amen.
Please be seated.
For communion this morning, the ushers will usher you forward. And if you would like wine, please take an empty glass. There will also be cups of grape juice up there. In the silver dish, there's gluten-free wafers. Come forward, receive the bread and the wine. And if you would like to, you can pray and kneel at the altar.
Thank you.
Now may the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Amen. Please rise as you're able. Let us pray. Holy God, you have welcomed us to this meal and fed us with dignity at your table. Send us now to welcome others and to be at peace with one another. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Please receive the blessing. God Almighty, God most merciful, bless you, keep you, and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Go in peace, follow Jesus. Thanks be to God.